Adam Kinzinger, proudly representing the 16th District and on the line with us right now. Congressman, good morning to you.
My man.
How are you? How's everything going this morning?
You know, it's not too bad. Just, you know, out here trying to resist the crazy. You know, we got the Green New Deal and all kinds of fun things going on out here. So
yeah, I'm voting. I'm voting present for it. That's how committed I am to
it. I know, isn't that crazy? Like, you know, that's the one thing actually I learned when I came out here. So in the Illinois State House, of which I was never a member of, thankfully, but, you know, they vote present all the time, and which is weird.
Yeah.
I came out here, and I remember being told, don't ever vote present. You vote present once every 2 years, and that's the first quorum call of Congress. After that, don't vote present, or everybody will hate you. So.
Yeah, boy, there was a lot of voting present there, which, you know, if this was such a great deal, $32 trillion worth, you know, why weren't we jumping up and down going, yeah, I'm for that?
You know, and we get paid a decent salary out here, so you get paid to make decisions. I mean, there's a lot of votes I take, including some, you know, this week that are going to be tough. But, you know, that's why people pay me, not to just be like, I'm here, but I have no opinion.
Right. I'm here, but I have no opinion. There was a vote. There was a vote well used right there.
That's right. Thank you, America.
Speaking of things to talk about, vote on and kick around, boy, the talk about the crisis at the border, the shutting down of the border. You've gone on record as saying you're not for shutting down the border. Am I right?
Yeah, but I think it's a little nuanced. Like, I think when you talk about generally shutting down the border, I mean, keep in mind, Mexico's our third largest trading partner. There's a massive economic impact in real terms, especially in, like, the Rockford area where it's so heavy in manufacturing. So in real terms, but also in psychological terms. You know, the real fight we're fighting right now is, so you take, like, El Salvador, Honduras, et cetera. The Chinese are really trying to kind of take that area over. So this is the other reason I said, you know, getting rid of the funding to these countries, all that's going to happen is China's going to come in and say, how much was the U.S. giving you? $150 million? Okay, we'll make it $200 million. And these countries are all going into the, you know, orbit of China. So I think at this time, especially when Central and South America is on the verge of this kind of conservative revolution or movement towards democracy and freedom, I think it's important for us to stay engaged. Now, I don't mind shutting down parts of the border to send a very strong message that Mexico needs to step up. I just think when you say we're going to shut down the whole border, it's kind of cutting off your nose to spite your face.
Now, a lot of people have opinions on it, the border and all that, but you are a member of Congress who has spent significant amounts of time down there.
Yeah. Yeah, I did 4 deployments, and most members of Congress will tell you, and there's nothing wrong with this. They'll tell you they've been to the border, so now they're experts. That doesn't make you an expert. You know, they throw on a windbreaker and go down and see it doesn't make you an expert. But having been involved in the operations, you do. And I am more convinced than anybody that it is a absolute massive crisis, that we need to build a wall and a barrier. And I think the president did the right thing by declaring a national emergency. You know, it's a problem. And frankly, to be honest, I mean, shutting down the border, it's not like it's actually going to end illegal immigration. It'll continue because the border's illegal to cross anyway.
Right.
It just really harms the commerce side of things.
So, no real net benefit on stopping people who are going to try to run across anyway because it's too porous, but the economic hammer ends up getting dropped on us.
Yeah, and the purpose in kind of closing, and the president saying he might close the border, is to compel Mexico to enforce their own border. I like that, you know, idea. But again, why would it compel Mexico? Because it's damaging to their economy. Why is it, if it's damaging to their economy, it's very damaging to our economy too. So I appreciate what the president's trying to do. I just disagree with that tactic.
Tell me a little bit about the Steve Scalise's discharge petition on the Born Alive legislation. I saw you tweet about that.
Yeah, so I got to sign that. Basically, you know, the Democrats here refused to take up a bill that says, you know, if you are born in the case during an abortion, you have to live, you know, or the doctors have to do everything they can to save your life. If you remember the governor of Virginia and New York and now what Illinois is doing, basically saying you can abort up until the moment of, you know, natural birth. And then even after that, if you intended to abort the baby and it was born, you just basically let it die. I mean, it's a disgusting thing. And I would encourage anybody, you know, I'd say about a week ago, I looked up again partial birth abortion and the process of it, you know, because I knew, but I looked at it, and it was Wikipedia, so this isn't like some conservative thing, and as I was reading it, it just made me sick. And
yep.
You realize, you know, I don't talk about abortion a ton because in my view, it's, you know, everybody's got their mind made up, But now's the time to stand up again on this, because we're not just trending to this idea of, oh, it's a woman's right. It's now up to literal infanticide, which I think all abortion is, but, you know, is unarguably infanticide, and I think we have to stand up. So I signed the discharge petition. It's not going to get to 218, probably, but it's important we make the message.
Oh, absolutely, and especially when you look at, you know, different Hollywood people down there trying to hold Georgia around the neck, saying, well, we'll stop filming our shows down here and doing our movies down here if you don't just go with unrestricted abortion.
Well, and think about this, too. Yeah, first off, yes. I mean, but Hollywood's got a job. It's pretty basic. It's to entertain us. It's not to get involved in our politics. Let politicians do that, and then, you know, we're not going out there trying to act in movies. And, you know, even though I'd probably be better than half these guys. But anyway,
I have no doubt.
You know, but the other thing is New York City. I mean, we build, you know, the World Trade Center comes down. We build a new World Trade Center, you know, to make a point that, you know, America's back, you know, kind of in memory of these 3,000 people that died. And they light it up pink or purple or whatever in celebration of abortion to the last second. I mean, it's disgusting. God had to have shed a tear that day. And you know, ultimately, I put my future in his hands and the future of this country in his hands. But we got to do everything we can to fight, to defend it.
You're just joining us, spending a little time with Congressman Adam Kinzinger. The ongoing attempt to mine more out of the Mueller report. You know, I see Mr. Nadler, who's just seemingly a lovely man.
Yeah.
Boy, we're not going to let this go. And boy, we're not being told the whole deal. And we're going to keep mining on this one. At what point does fatigue set in, even in the most devoted people like him?
Well, this is what's happened. I mean, you had an entire Democratic Party that for 2.5 years, 2 years has built, well, I guess 2.5, has built this narrative that Trump is, you know, sold out to the Russians. And what I said at the beginning is, okay, the Mueller report's happening, fine. But everybody has to accept the results when it comes out. You know, if it comes out and says he colluded, I'll accept that, and I'll take appropriate action. If it comes out and says he didn't collude, then Democrats need to accept that. And that's what obviously happened, and they can't, because their entire 2.5-year resistance philosophy was not based on politics. It was based on Donald Trump has sold out to the Russians. And fine, you don't like the president, that's fine, right? You can not like him.
Sure.
But you can't keep making up this thing. And it's funny, because I'll say on different media venues and stuff like, hey, the president of the United States is actually one of the most hawkish people against Russia in my lifetime. I know foreign policy. And people laugh. They literally just refuse to accept it when I say lethal weapons to Ukraine. More sanctions have been put on Russia than anywhere. We killed 500 Russian soldiers in Syria. You can't get any more hawkish than that. And people literally just refuse to believe what you say, and it's gotten to the point where you can't even argue. I mean, you can show somebody a puppy dog and say, this is a puppy, and they're like, nope, it's not, because I don't want to believe it's a puppy.
Right.
Like, all right, whatever.
Yeah, the president says it's a puppy, I know it's a cat.
Yeah, that's right, and that's literally the point we're at. And so people need to let this go. The president deserves a fair shake, right? He deserves now the chance to be president. You can fight him on merits. But to continue to hang a cloud, I mean, the last two Republican presidents, the Democrats have said are illegitimate. You know, Bush because of Florida,
yep,
and now Trump because of Russia. It's literally terrible.
Yeah, it's become a pattern, and even speaking of Georgia, you know, we just the current governor now called illegitimate by the person he defeated by 54,000 votes who refuses to let it go.
But then the president, you know, makes comments. I was at the hour-and-a-half-long speech, which was incredibly, like, how do you speak for an hour and a half?
Right.
I was at that speech with the president the other night, and, you know, he called in, you know, the fact is, but now all said, oh, the president, you know, undermining our election system. But by the way, the governor of Georgia is illegitimate, and the president's illegitimate.
Right.
Little double standard there.
Yeah, but at least we're loud with it. That's
right,
the important
exactly
thing.
Yeah.
That's the important thing.
And we have cool celebrities saying it.
Oh, well, that's what you need. Oh, and one of those, speaking of cool celebrities and all that, I was lucky enough and honored enough to host the Lincoln Day dinner a week or so back.
Yeah.
And your introduction, your video introduction for Rodney Davis was outstanding. And by the way, I sat at the table with him. What a terrific guy.
He's a great guy. You know, it's funny because they had this script written for me, and I'm like, no, I'm just going to wing it here. And, you know, I unfortunately couldn't make it. I was out of the country, but I heard it was a great dinner. I heard you did a good job. I heard he did a great job. He's a great guy, and you know, he's got one of the toughest races in the state of Illinois. He barely won last time, and, you know, and he gets a lot of Democratic support. So this is where, you know, as you look at people, whether it's me or Rodney or anybody out here, you know, as Republicans, we have to look and say, okay, somebody may not be with us on 100% of issues, or, you know, maybe they're with us 95% of issues, but holding these Republican seats is the most important thing right now, because the Democrats are coming after us, and they want to turn Illinois into California. Trust me.